Greetings, petrolheads. Welcome back to Automation, the car company Tycoon game. So, last time we built a new hot hatchback for ESE, and well, today I'm gonna build a new generation for the ESE entry-level sports car using, you know, another version of that, or a new version, I guess we could say, of that turbocharged 994 engine. I'm gonna make it probably a little bit smaller. And let's see, which body could I use for an entry-level sports car? I was sort of thinking about this, but then this is sort of not really that suitable, I think. This right here is also more of a bigger sports car. This is also more of a coupe based on a four-door saloon, as you can see here in the selection of body styles. And this one, I think we've used before, didn't we? What is the difference between this and this? Oh, this is a coupe and this is a convertible. Okay. And again, like, it's not a bad thing if we're gonna use the same body twice. Right, and make this a little bit less steep, and we need some bigger arches. Good. Right. This being entry level, it's gonna have corrosion resistant steel panel chassis for now. Longitudinal engine placement, McPherson's multi-link, and then probably just corrosion resistant steel here again. .285s on the rear max. That's a little bit excessive for what this thing's gonna make. But 205's front should really be, you know, the bare minimum. Actually, I really dislike the way that McPherson's allow for much narrower tires than double wishbones. You can see here, now we can only use 205's. With double wishbones, we can use 255's. So I'm gonna go with double wishbones. And pretty much like this. Right. So we choose this grill. Then we put a lip on this thing. Mostly for, you know, aesthetic reasons. I think I wanna try and make this thing look a little different. So let's go with this grill here. And then put some fog lights down there. Along with the number plate, I think this rounds up a relatively, you know, sleek and sporty, but also not super expensive look. Like, this is gonna look like your traditional sort of budget sports car, which is sort of what this is gonna be, isn't it? And then 1999, What sort of headlights could we use? Are there more options from this one? Yes, we could use. Thing like this. No, that's just that doesn't look right. The problem is that somewhere here, like from here onwards, you can't put headlights further up than that. We could use the same sort of headlights we've used on the hatchback, which would be another thing they have in common, aside from, like, apart from the engine, which, you know, they're gonna share the same block. Also doesn't look really all that good. Let's see, are there more options of what are we missing? There we go. What if we turn this around? That looks pretty similar to the sort of Fiat Coupe kind of headlights that we already tried. This looks better, doesn't it? And it is gonna have indicators inside here, so we don't need extra indicators on these headlights. Right, then some side indicators. I guess we're gonna put them here, since I can't put them on the, like, on in this general area on the fender. And also, as I've noticed, this is sort of "quote unquote" unique to me. Apparently, is that I put indicators also on the rear fender, not only on the front ones. I've never really paid attention to that on real life cars. I don't know how many real life cars have indicators on the rear bumpers. Or on the rear fenders, rather. But I guess some of them do. I mean, I'm pretty sure I'm not coming up with anything new here. But, you know, it was pointed out that this is something relatively, you know, not relatively uncommon anyway. Yeah, I think I'm gonna stick with these taillights for now. And then I'm gonna connect the taillights with something along these lines. Then make the batch a little bit smaller and place it on here. So gonna take this, clone it and change, you know, the nature of it, if you will. Why does this add to the cooling airflow? It's at the back and the engine is gonna be up front. I don't think this is gonna contribute very much to the cooling, but you know, what do I know? Okay. With a big lip on the back like this, this car almost says like, hey, no need to do aftermarket body work. ESE has done it for you. Braking lights there as well, and I think that's fine for now. What color do we want to give this thing? Red? Almost sort of Ferrari red-ish. Yeah, okay, I'm gonna stick with that. Rear drive. Engine. We have a 1998 ESE engine block. That is the 2-liter 16 valve. Right. We're gonna clone this thing. And we're certainly not gonna put a 300 horsepower version of this in this budget car. And we're not gonna put lightweight forged pistons in here. We're probably gonna put these in here and reduce RPM limit to like 6500. Yeah, I guess maybe forged pistons. They're still a lot less expensive than lightweight forged ones. Obviously we're gonna reduced boost to a more reasonable amount, reduce the AR ratio, the compressor size, the turbine size, and no, not the turbine size that much, but mainly the VVL profile, we need to reduce that. Oh, and we need ball bearing. I think I haven't done that on the other turbo, which is why it kicked in so late. But the ball bearing is certainly something we should have been using there as well. Right, 236 horsepower is still too much. I think what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna make this thing a little bit smaller, so go down to like 1.8 liters or so. 85 by what? 79, 85 by 79, okay, good. And 220 horsepower, maybe still a little bit much. Certainly we're gonna run this thing less rich, a bit leaner. horsepower. You can still go a little bit lower than that. Let's aim for like 200 horsepower if we can. We're still making the power relatively late. Well, I guess 7,000 RPM rev limit is still okay. 200 horsepower, good amount of torque, good torque band. Yeah, I think this is gonna be fine. Oh, also the exhaust is too big, isn't it? It was fine actually, but we can go a little bit. That's 201 now. Can we go up to 200 horsepower somehow? Yeah, like that. Okay. Viscous LSD is good enough for this guy. And what kind of top speed are we looking at? 236? Something like that. Sports tires, I guess. No, I think this one is gonna be fine on medium compound road tires. Also, these headlights. They're so long, they go all the way into the fenders and onto the wheels. Not very practical. But in any case, steel rims are gonna be fine probably. No, you know what, I'm gonna go for less tire here. 215s front, 225s rear should be totally okay. Maybe even 225s all around. rims. Because they look good. That's what people say anyway. This is the sort of car that you buy and then you can mod it. I mean, obviously, first of all, let's look at how expensive it's gonna be. I guess I sort of have a suspicion that it might be a little bit more expensive than I'm thinking right now. Let's go for a on the tray. Then two seats. Standard interior, basic infotainment. You know what? Let's give this a sport interior. Which is a lot more expensive than a standard one. A lot more. But maybe if we reduce the quality a little bit to make it a little bit cheaper. And then, because it's an entry level car, you can't really trust the buyers to have, you know, the required driving skill. I'm gonna give it traction control, standard safety, standard springs, monotube dampers, passive sway bars, and we are gonna tune the suspension a little bit and reduce the ride height. 30 point. Okay, the there is some oversteer. Okay, good. Not anymore. So now we have a car that handles about as poorly as it gets without actually oversteering. Now, for the brake setup, brake balance, we need to reduce the rear brakes. Also, the fronts are too big, aren't they? Yeah. Okay, 228 kilometers an hour at top speed now. Okay, that's good. That's good. Seconds acceleration time is certainly quick enough for an entry-level sports car. Oh, actually, it is not as expensive as I expected now. I mean, I was kind of thinking it might be a little expensive because we do have a limited slip differential. We do have vented discs rather than solid discs. And we have a sports interior. That is A-okay. This price is fine. $16,700 is certainly cheap enough. Fun pre. ~12% affordability for the fun budget category. What kind of price are you expecting? $5,000 for a new car? That is fun? Like, come on. It's just not realistic. Let's see what she does around the FL track. Keep in mind that the time's gonna be faster. Goes quite well, actually. And 128.07. Where could we run this thing around? I mean, it's not going to be competitive around here, around Laguna Seca. It is only a relatively cheap car anyway, a relatively cheap rear-wheel drive car anyway. But just to see. So the flying lap would be 154.43, which is actually not that bad. I mean, what kind of car can you buy these days for $16,700? You can buy what can you buy? A Ford Focus. And a Ford Focus for $16,700 would probably not be as quick as this thing, if I had to guess. Drivability is really low, that's kind of worrying me though. Understand the rules. Yeah, that is. I mean, I want to keep this thing more on the sporty side though, because it is meant to be a budget sports car, right? And it's supposed to be fun. It's supposed to be fun to drive, and sportiness is at 39.6, which is pretty good. Economy is 25.8 mpg, that's acceptable, I guess. US mpg, that is. In British mpg, that would be a lot more. But in any case, that would be the 1999 ESE entry level Mark II. Still need a name for this guy. That's the 200, I guess, for 200 horsepower. And overall, I think, like, what sort of market are we looking at? We're looking at the market that is populated by cars like the Nissan S line, like the Silvias, if you will, the S14s, S15s, and whatnot. We're looking for maybe the Honda S2000 is a little bit little bit above this sort of class, because it is quite a bit more powerful and also more expensive. What else is there in this category? Honestly, you can see that I know nothing about Japanese sports cars, so I apologize. But anyway, this is, I think this is pretty good for the money, and for 1999, 200 horsepower is definitely enough. It doesn't weigh very much. Weight distribution is pretty good actually, 52.5 to 47.5. Relatively close to a 50-50. And the quarter mile happens in 14.6 seconds. That's not too shabby. So I hope you guys enjoyed this episode. Leave a like or a comment if you did. Thank you for watching. I'll see you next time.